I'm happy to introduce Megan Koski, University of River Falls. River Falls coaching staff is making their presence known at the clinic this year. Megan's going to talk about obviously distance running and personal stuff, culture stuff, and training all in one. And let's welcome Megan here. We'll get going.
The teammates that we had was the reason why we stayed there at that time. invested in a place that I loved. So obviously competed and did all the different running things, but as I quit the chiropractic job, I went and started coaching at Holy Family in Victoria. So that was really fun for me just to carry that excitement in and say, let's make little changes to these high school students and see big, big, big jumps. Very, very fun with that. From there, I moved to Alabama. My husband is in the military. So I started doing my graduate assistantship, and that was, again, another life change that said, we're going to invest in this. We're taking this seriously. You don't need a master's degree to be a coach, but it sure does help. So I started doing my graduate assistantship, as well as receiving my master's for sport management. While there, I was able to work with the cross-country track teams at the University of South Alabama, which is a Division I program, and that was something to me. You see in the NCAA world, kids from different countries, and these athletes that are just incredible, Kenyans and Norwegians and Danish athletes. That was the first time I had been exposed to them. And my role that I took on and assigned to myself was, how am I going to connect with these athletes so that they feel confident in what they're doing? And that's where I got to work with them a lot more on the mental side of things, instead of really writing the training or implementing the training. But still a really, really great experience for me working with Coach Cowles, who's the head distance coach down there. Awesome mentor, and I think he appreciated my female presence as well to connect with some of those women on different levels. From there, we moved to Nebraska, or to Omaha, where I was an assistant coach for the University of Nebraska Omaha's women's team. They have women only for cross and track, no men. Again, that was another way that I could insert myself and say, you're doing the training just fine. You're finding this rhythm just fine, but something's still missing. What is it? And we could break it down and have those conversations to figure out what we need to do. So then, as things changed and transitioned, my husband very, very willingly, maybe willingly, supported us with just his salary, right, for a long time. And I knew that to be in this field, especially collegiately, you just have to pay your dues. So thankfully, my husband said, I'll carry the weight of this on my back, but we got to figure it out. So when the application arose for River Falls, took a chance on it. I wanted to be myself throughout the entire interview process, throughout the entire just how am I going to insert myself into the collegiate world? I'm going to be me. And if nobody likes that, that's fine. But I think some people might, and I want to go where I'm wanted. So I applied, got my interview, and now I get to step into a program that I get to do it my way. That sounds a little bit kind of cocky and pretentious, but I walked into this as a history. We also have a River Falls alum in the crowd as well, and maybe you can attest to this. There was a kind of, the women won a national championship in 2008, and since then there have been 13 different track coaches and 10 different cross-country coaches. So there is no wonder that there is just no bill, there's no vision, there's no dream. So our chancellor decided to take a step and say, athletics, what's going on for all the sports, but specifically cross country and track, what's going on? So she adopted the director who, if any of you have seen Andy today, he's our director, he oversees everything, and a head coach model. So I stepped into the head cross country role model, and he looks over all, but I'm actually the first full-time head cross country coach in River Falls history. Being 27 years old and being a woman, I am extremely proud of that, and that has led into, again, me staying true to who I am and how I'm going to make an impact on this world, right? So that's a little bit about me. Trust me, this is, again, kind of building that credibility. Obviously, I have my personal success, working through a couple different aspects of those life challenges, advocating for myself, finding ways to lean on others for support. I believe I'm a pretty mentally tough individual, and I have a lot of thanks to give to my high school coaches to be able to respond to adversity, but also understand that you're not doing it alone. So that's a big thing that I'll continue to push throughout the rest of this presentation. Again, advocating for myself, I have mentors that I was coached by who are in the Hall of Fame. I have women's mentors through the NCAA, through the women's mentorship program I applied for, and then also just the ones that I've coached with. I am a culmination of all of them, and I want to continue to build and make a mark that would make them proud. I also had some coaches in college that I wanted to stay as far away as possible, so I learned what not to do as well in that sense. people know that you've dedicated and devoted a little bit of your life to learning. And also my master's degree, like I said, helps out. It's not a defining characteristic, but it's a little checkbox. So my coaching strategy, and I think for every single coach, whatever event you're coaching, you have to have some sort of philosophy. For a long time, I didn't believe that. I was just like, you know, you're going to coach and you're going to do it your way, and you just don't have this overarching message that you need to preach to people. And then after the past kind of year and a half, I'm like, maybe we should have a little bit of like a direction I want to go to. So my coaching philosophy is short and sweet. It's being comfortable, being uncomfortable. And that doesn't just mean training. That doesn't just mean the workouts or the lifting. It means confronting your academics, talking with your professors, advocating for yourself, talking about mental health, all these different things that come into who you are as a student athlete. So people first, 100%. I know I have the time as a full-time head college coach to write individual plans and create individual paces. How are you all going to manage that, right? I will let you know, hopefully, and later on. Open and honest communication. There's no better feeling than knowing that you're going to be able to be honest with somebody, and they're going to be able to say, I understand you, and I'm going to do what you ask because I respect you and trust you. Science-based for me, training based on your results. Your results are going to set your new goals. Obviously, if you were in here to hear Jason, the past two sessions, I don't even want to start even trying to be better than him or explain anything more than him, because he understands that as well as I do, but it's just many roads to Rome, right? So trying different things. That top bullet over there, food is fuel, that is something I will preach through the day is done. And I have a little bit of nutrition later on as well. Consistency, this relates to high school as well as college, right? You want to be able to make 4 years last. You don't want to have these freshmen that come in and then disappear as sophomores or wait till their senior year to get this opportunity. That's probably when it's going to come, just because they're stronger, more experienced. But how are we going to continue to keep them involved, keep them invested for 4 years and beyond? Academics at the collegiate level, we have to have a 2.0 to stay eligible in the NCAA. At high school, you got to set yourself up to get to college, right? So making those plans, getting into your routine, how are your academics going to make your life choices easier? Respect, obviously, each other, process, yourself, competitors, authority. That is just basics, right? Teaching your kids how to be good humans. Right? It doesn't matter if they're the best athlete on the team or the worst, they have to be a good human. And they have to be somebody that walks into a competition, walks into practice, and makes everybody else's day better. It's exhausting, right? To choose positivity, and how are we always going to have these good kids that are just awesome and making a difference? But it's not hard to take that time to show the basics, right? Lastly, learn, try, fail, grow. That is when you're going to succeed. You have to learn the new things. Trying to try them, you're going to fail, and you're going to fail hard sometimes. How are you going to grow and respond to those, and how are you going to get that success from them? I had a recruit about a month and a half ago, and her dad came up to me, and he goes, do you find it hard coaching men? I was like, what? He's like, do you find it hard relating to them and coaching men? And I thought about it for like a second, and I was like, no. And he goes, well, why not? And I said, because at the end of the day, boys are going to sometimes act like girls, and girls are sometimes going to act like boys, and their emotional maturity is not where we want it to be, and sometimes you just have to treat them as humans. And he looked at me, and he was like, oh, okay. How do you do that? And I said, I expect respect. I know I am a young coach. I know I'm a female, but that doesn't mean you get to treat me any differently. I know what I'm talking about. And clearly, you're getting stronger. You're getting better. And that's just how it's going to go, right? It sounds intimidating, but you have to be able to establish those boundaries and establish that respect to be able to get that from your athletes. Obviously, there are those appropriate boundaries, right? We want to make sure we still lay down the law, but building that trust with your athletes is going to go a really, really long way. Listen to them. Obviously, boys and girls, they respond differently. They're going through different times in their lives. Listen to them. Hear them out. You really don't know for sure what they're going through. You really don't know how they're feeling. Take the time to listen to them and hear them. There's different stressors going on in different lives. Doesn't matter, right? They're humans and their feelings are valid. Take that time to listen to them. You ultimately, as coaches, have the last. take them into consideration and see how they truly feel. Fairness, that again, you can't just coddle a baby girl because she's struggling today because of her period. If I ever hear that excuse, they're out of practice for the day because we're all going through it. We all have it at different times. It's not something we can make an excuse. Guys, you guys need to make sure that you're mature, you're respectable, you are treating those women with respect at any level. Again, it's a lot of things that sound intimidating, it sounds frustrating, and how do I get my kids to act like this, right? Be an example of it yourself, but also show them how. A lot of times they grow up in families that maybe don't ever treat them with respect, or maybe don't talk to them in a certain way, and they are looking to you to be that person. Take the time to listen and see what they need. Empathize. What else is going on? You never really know. I had a student athlete this entire fall devoted his life to cross country. He was my number three runner and did very, very well. He came back after break just a week ago. He came into my office and he said, "Coach, I'm dropping out of school. I need to go to inpatient help for my mental health." Whoa. Okay. I knew we had struggles and I knew we were going through different things. Did I know the extent? Clearly not. That is something else that's going on, and for him to come in and say that to me and make that choice, ultimate respect for him. He is one of my captains as well, leading by example. That's going to build that culture, that's going to build that trust to say, we're gonna just work together, right? There's nothing more important than your life, especially not at this point of your journey, right? Like I said, hold them accountable. If you hear cuss words, if you hear different things going on, call them out on it, right? You don't need that behavior. Something I learned as my experience, talk to them in private. A lot of the boys specifically get embarrassed. They want to put on this show and be the big dog on campus. Call them in your office or call them over at practice and explain your mental thought process, right? Don't just attack them, tell them everything that's wrong. Invite them in to share their thoughts. Why did you say that? Were you trying to hurt somebody? What were you doing that for? Try not to embarrass them in those situations where they don't want to feel attacked, in a sense. I also have a zero drama policy. I had a couple of girls come to my office complaining about boy issues. As soon as they said it was about a boy, I was pretty much like, go talk to the boy. I don't need to handle this, right? There are real world things going on. Again, with boys and girls, you just have to make sure that you know what is worth talking about. Engage with each other, support each other. This was from our team camp earlier this year. I was so impressed because they invested in one another. They put their phones down. They took time to understand each other. They were very, very vulnerable and open. And that bled into the entire cross-country season where they knew that I could rely on you to talk to, I could trust you, and you're going to be somebody that can advocate for me. Bottom lines, treat them the same, be honest and consistent, and establish respect. I think if you follow those three things, you'll have issues, right, with girls and boys, everybody's unpredictable. But if you follow those three things, you will be able to connect with them on a deeper level that you're going to just see them as humans for specifically boys, specifically girls. Okay? And like I mentioned, women coaching, I'm very proud of it. And I want women, especially the women that have gone before me and the ones that are going to come after me, to look at my program and see she's confident in herself. She trusts herself to develop and trust athletes the same way. Okay, a little bit of the training. Here's what I do in terms of the start of every season. If you were in here last time, you saw Jason go over the macrocycles, the mesocycles, the microcycles. Here's my example of that. A little bit more practical. I love to include, this is for me, I'm not an organized person. I don't know the other word that I am very focused, but I'm not extremely organized. But I want to make sure I have all the important dates, right? If you're going to meet at a different course, if you're going to meet at a different time, include that on there, right? So have everything laid out so you have a little bit of an idea of where you're going to compete, when you're going to compete, how to build your mileage, everything from there. Important dates, team camps. We have a lot of compliance meetings. one complaint I get from NCAA, or from student athletes at the collegiate level is, why did we never get to know what we were doing at practice at in high school until the day of? And that is something I also struggle with, sorry Jane. I didn't know what we were doing all day long, and I would get to practice and she'd be like, today's the hardest workout of the year. I'm like, thanks, I had a granola bar. That's it, right? So allowing your athletes to know, if it's just a weekly plan, they don't need to know the whole thing because this is going to be in pencil, right? With other factors that come up, top guy gets injured, you have to swap, how does this all work? Have a map in pencil that you can follow. Obviously, I send out practice plans, and I'll show you examples of those every Saturday so that they can plan their weeks. They have enough going on with work and class and other practices and band and choir and everything else that they're being pulled to. Allow them to invest in it and mentally prepare for it. I think that creating that routine is super, super important. So that they can also visualize. You ask them for Gale Woods specifically, right? Sit down, think of that first 800 and that death hill, right? You want them to prepare for that. Translate that into your practices, right? So you have the hardest workout on Tuesday. Let them prepare for that. You're gonna be hitting these paces, this part I want you to focus. You're gonna be running with these people. Okay, I'm gonna sit here and I'm gonna visualize this workout. It becomes a little bit easier for them to translate that to their races, okay? That's something I've started doing, and I was just telling one of the other coaches, one of the athletes I have, story time. Wednesday, we were doing a workout, it was mile repeats, and I clumped my top three girls together. They were about a minute apart in their 6Ks, but I just needed them to think of running together and having that encouraging group. One of the girls, the top girl, she was running pretty comfortably, her mile repeats, and she was gonna drop down number 5 and number 6. The other two were training and racing together the entire season, but I just, again, wanted them all together. 3 reps in of the total 5 that they were going to be doing, one of the girls that was been running a little bit slower than the top girl stopped and threw a fit and said, why are we doing this? She's not even struggling. I'm working so hard. What the heck? And I stopped her and I said, really, is this the time to have this? And she's like, well, fine, I'm done. I said, no, if you want to continue talking, let's hash it out. For about 2 more minutes, she continued to yell at me and continued to say this wasn't fair and continued to have a breakdown. To that, which I said, if you want to go home, go home. I'm not going to have this conversation right now. It is not the time or place. I sent out the practice plans on Saturday, and you knew this workout was coming on Saturday. If you want to know your pace, you want to know the idea of it, you want to know why you're doing this, ask before practice, okay? So when you are able to give them as much information as possible, it helps them understand why they're doing what they're doing, what your expectation of them is in that workout, and how they're going to build that confidence stepping into that workout as well, okay? Has anybody felt those same experiences, or is it just me getting yelled at by athletes? Thank goodness, sorry it happened, but I'm glad we're on the same boat. Asterisk next to weekly mileage. Off to the left here is my progression. I usually follow a 3-week build, 1-week recovery throughout the season. The blue mark is our peak week that we hit 100% of our max mileage. I have 25 student athletes. You guys have potentially 50 to 100, right? That's a lot more than me. But what I do is I create training logs and I create individual plans based on the students' history. So I know coming from programs, they might have only touched 40 miles per week. We're gonna go up to maybe 42, just to get a little bit comfortable, especially as they transition into college where class is different, life is different, friends are different, eating's different, everything's different. I wanna make sure we can manage our mileage before we go up. So I have top athletes running 75, 80. I have others that are coming in still top athletes, but running 40, maybe 35. So understanding your athletes, and maybe it is breaking it down into, this plan is for my athletes that I know are seniors and juniors that have run 50 miles a week before. Here are for the athletes that ran cross country, are doing Nordic, and now they're gonna go on the track, right? Here's another group that injury prone, I don't know what we're gonna do with them, but we're gonna build them a mileage, hopefully. And here's another group where we just gotta see and wait and maybe develop even more. That ties back into that 4-year progression. So in my program, we start, I bring athletes in as freshmen, we're going to bump them up maybe 5 to 10% again, like all those other life factors. The summer going into their sophomore cross country, we're going to bump them up in the summer just to see how that works. My top guy, Logan, last year, he came in, he was about 45, so I was like, okay, we're pushing him, we're at the 8K now, let's try this. We pushed him up to 55. His back ended up having a little bit of injury as well as his hip flexors within 2 weeks after that 55 mile week. So, okay, maybe it's a fluke, maybe there are other things going on, so we went up to 55 again. IT bands shut down. So clearly with Logan, I mean, I know we could try again and again and again, but at one point I'm going to draw a line and say, we're comfortable at 45. Your workouts and your races are quality. We're going to stick you at 45. So understanding your people, understanding their strengths, understanding their mileage is going to help in terms of this. Be organized, create routine. I know like Jason said, don't follow into a specific patterns. For me personally, I have found when they get into those rhythms and routines to create that process and understand what they're going to accept, it's much more likely to give you that energy on that day. Okay, so play around with it, find that, but make sure you have a roadmap in pencil that you can change. Coaching key factors, obviously like I mentioned with mileage, having intention behind each mileage. I think there are some programs that just say you have to run X amount of miles, and yes, I'm not saying you don't have to run to be good. You have to run miles to build a lot of different factors. Understand why. Help them understand why you're doing mile repeats versus 400 meter repeats today. Why are you doing a tempo run versus a progression run? Explaining them why they have intentions behind those miles. And like your top athletes who do need to hit 60 or 70 miles a week, why are you doing a double? When are you doing a double? How are you getting in those extra miles? Are you feeling crappy? Do you feel okay? Look at their workouts, look at their races, especially workouts you've done in the past. Are they getting faster? Are they getting stronger? Key thing I usually change is mileage before anything else to see, okay, are we reacting a little bit better to more or less, taking that away. Explain Logan. Kaylin was one of my inherited ladies from the previous coach. Coming into my first year, last year, in the summer, she ran 9 miles the entire summer. That should give you a little glimpse of the people that I inherited into this program. And so we went into cross country season, and within 2 weeks, her shins were not working anymore. And I wanted to feel bad, but also you're a varsity cross country athlete at an NCAA level. I didn't know I had to worry about that. So her and I sat down in a conversation. I said, first, is this what you want to do? You don't need to struggle and you don't need to put yourself through all of this to hurt. She said, yes, I want to do this. I want to give you a chance. I want to see what your coaching is like. I said, okay. We made a plan all of last year from August to May. Kaylin ran 2 days a week. She cross trained 3. She took 1 day off and she raced Saturday. She made it through. Cross country was a little bit of a struggle, but once we got to track and we worked together again, she went from 235 to 222 in the 800 in just 3 months. She got it. She understood that I was going to be there for her. I wasn't just going to give up on her. We were going to work together to have those conversations. This summer, after track conference last year, we built her up 100%. She started at 4 miles a week, went to 8, went to 12. I told her that this is going to be the hardest thing probably you've done in your running career for a while, to have that patience, to trust, and commit to that. She ended up going from a 2507 6K to 2353 in that 6K this year, and she just opened up last weekend with a 219.800. She is trusted, she is bought in because we have worked through it together. You are gonna have those athletes that don't do what you ask, and there is a line, right? How much am I willing to give to you when I have 99 others that I have to care about? Taking that time to develop that one could be just the one that rises to the top. So, understand your athletes. Sam is the one that's been just fine. He is the one that continued to push mileage. He's at 75 now. He went from 17.5 in the 5K to 15.59 last year. He's understanding, buying into that program, understanding that I'm here. I'm not going anywhere. Let's work through those things. Obviously, the injury history, I've given you those examples. Slow build, we talked about that. High school, sometimes even into early college, there are those body development changes and the puberty. I would be dumb to say that weight doesn't play a factor, right? It definitely do that. How you go about that. I am a firm believer, and I learned this, thank you, Jane, that everybody can run, right? Everybody has to just adapt to how that's going to look for them. Building up slowly, finding your efficiency in your form, finding the ways that your body can react to different things is the most important part. So understand those changes. What is happening with you? What is going on? Is it the freshman 15, or is it your birth control? Or is it your partying and drinking beer every night? Hopefully not in high school, but you never know. How are you going to work with those athletes to figure it out? I think that's something that, again, goes through each athlete, and those are conversations that you have to be honest with. And again, that's maybe goes back to coaching boys versus girls, right? You can tell boys you have to put on 10 pounds of muscle and they're going to do it. Girls, how do you approach that subject of weight? I was very, very fortunate in high school to have a coach that understood and also cared what my body could do and how it could do it well, with fueling properly, bringing desserts to Saturday morning practices, and taking care of us. When I went into college, I had a coach that was pretty much the complete opposite and was scared to go to dinner after the team meets because she was going to be watching everything I ate. So how are you going to approach that with each individual? You could tell one girl, you need to lose 5 pounds and you'll run faster. Can't tell other girls, right? So work with them, find out ways that you can approach that from a healthy standpoint only. I never do bod pods, I never do weight check-ins, I was weighed in my coach's office in college, so we're not even gonna touch that. But how are you gonna approach it in a healthy way? The biggest thing I can advise would say go based off feel. If you're feeling hurt in your shins, if you're feeling hurt in your back, how are you gonna address those things to go based off feel? Ultimately, you may have to have that talk with a dietitian or maybe a doctor, but that's their realm, right? As coaches, we are gonna address the running side of things, and from there, we'll make those improvements. It's a very touchy subject for me, so I'm not gonna go into more of that, but the biggest thing, I think, as well, with the factor would be weightlifting, building that muscle, preventing the injury, increasing the bone mineral density. These are examples of the weightlifting we use right now. Just Coach Andy does a really good job implementing workouts and exercises that strengthen common injury areas. So we're going to do a lot of deadlifts to help with our hamstrings, and we're going to do a lot of core exercises to engage all of our different muscles. We're also going to put plates on the tips of our shins and lifts so we can strengthen those shins. So these are proven, they have done a very, very good job for our team so far. For me, I hated weightlifting in high school and in college. I just felt awkward, I felt embarrassed, I was not strong. And that, I think, led into me feeling like I wasn't good enough. So I think, again, you gotta confront your fears and get in there and be strong with it. So the weightlifting now and in high school, make it fun. Make it ways that especially athletes can feel empowered in there and not afraid to ask questions. Hop in and do it yourselves. Struggle. Put a little bit extra weight on and show them, okay, I gotta go down, right? So show them that you are a human as well and can understand that there are differences in that empowerment. But the weight room is crucial to keeping you injury-free, and the more you guys can invest in that now, I think will help them in the long run avoiding those injuries as well. Nutrition. Making sure they are eating throughout the day, breakfast, lunch, and snacks, dinner, going home, what to eat, right? I think talked with a dietitian at the U of M about a month ago, and she said iron, vitamin D, calcium, red meat, but that's iron. One other thing, but she said those three for sure, vitamin D, iron, and calcium, can't get enough of. So making sure, protein. And make sure that every meal has at least a substantial amount of protein. So making sure that your athletes provide them for you. If you can, if that's legal at the high school level, bring in good snacks. Teach them how to implement it into their days. Don't just expect them to know how to get good protein or how to get good iron. Help them teach and then let them go and figure it out for themselves. Key factors, again, academics, family life, sleep, mental health, and big changes that are coming or maybe are already happening. That's another key factor for me is understanding the athlete and what's all going on. So these are my sample weeks. I like to stay organized. I like to over-communicate. I talked about that. flexible per person, per workout, per season. Explain everything, ask them to repeat it, create ownership in their plan, and take the time to ask those questions. Per workout, I went to the coaches convention last year, and Diljit Taylor was presenting on mental health as well as team culture. And she said, the biggest thing that I can do for an athlete is give in to what they need. So she said, when I have athletes that come in and they're doing their workout and it's great, and they decide that they don't want to do the last rep, but come back for the 200s because those are fast and fun, she said, when they quit, they are done. So take that into your workouts. I have athletes that come up to me and do that all the time. Hey coach, I feel really gross right now. Can I skip this rep but then come in the next one? Nope, you have shut down, you are done. We will try again next time, but for today, you have already lost it. You do not believe in it anymore, and you need to go. Okay, so be aggressive, be upfront, but let them know that you can't just quit when it gets hard. Okay, you can't just have the fun stuff, which are the 200s at the end. This is how I run my weeks. So Sunday, we usually have an easy run, a long run, off day, cross-train day, depending on where we're at. The first one on the left is our first week of practice, so our first day, the past 2 years that I've been here, our first day is hills. And I can really tell quickly who did stuff over the summer and who did not. And then we went to camp for a couple of days, so I had a little bit of different things planned out. And then this was an example of our peak week. We had come off of Blue Gold at University of Wisconsin Eau Claire, and we went right into this heavy week, so they did hour-long progression runs, which crushed them. It was mentally, they were like, I can't do an hour-long progression, like, we're going to try. We're going to do it. And it happened to be like a random 90-degree day. I feel a little bad about it now, but it all PR'd later on, which was great. Mile repeats, we have a perfect 1,200-meter grass loop on our campus that I love sitting out there too. Same thing. Halfway through, they're like, we can't do this. And I'm like, you might not, but we're going to keep trying each rep, you know? So push them on tired legs, and I think that's something that I really like to do, is continue to push. After this 100% week of our low mileage, we dropped down to 70. With that, at my conference meet, I raced 14 athletes, 13 of the 14 had lifetime bests. Okay, so understand your roadmap, understand how to pressure them, how to push them, listen to them, hear their feedback. That's how I like to plan those out. Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, as I talked about, each person has their own mileage, so they're going to play out their weeks. They're going to know what they're going to do Sunday. They're going to know their mileage for Monday and Wednesday workup days, and they're going to know if Friday's pre-meet. They're going to know if that's an easy day. They're going to know if Saturday's a workout, an off day, or if they're going to be a meet. They can already plan out 4 of their 7 days of the week with their mileage. So Tuesday, Thursday, those are the days I like to let them take ownership. You might only need 3 miles on Tuesday. Great. Do 3 miles, and then we have a whole strength session that we do with just kind of PT-style exercises. They can say, I'm going to do my 3 mile run, come back, do my exercises, and then I'm going to get out of here because I have to work and I have class tonight. Perfect. I have nothing to do tonight. I'm going to front load my miles. I'm going to do 12 miles today, and then I can go 4 on Thursday because I can work on Thursday. Perfect. Be flexible. Those are the days that I like to connect to my athletes and see how they're doing, see how everything is, how's their family, and connect and take that time. Again, sample week, this was the kind of the crossover where I had kids competing at the regionals, as well as athletes that were starting their indoor goals, the ones that are a little bit more mid-distance. Their season ended at cross country, the meet before our conference meet. So that's a little bit of an example. We went back to the basics, started with some just basic tempo runs, just building that mileage, getting the hills in again, but also tapering off those NCAA regionals. And this was just this past week. I have 3 different groups, 800 mile, mile, 3K, 3K, 5K. I like to give a little bit of specifics so that, especially with the girls, I think that I always put them in it, but their comparison can get taken away when you can just put them into different groups seamlessly, teaching them just how to avoid or how to work with other groups, learn other people's rhythms. You can do that pretty seamlessly. So yeah, we've been building this week. This is another close to peak week. We are in our week 2 of our indoor season, so we're moving up pretty quickly here. This is our Tuesday, Thursday routine. strengthens the whole body. It does prevent a lot of injuries, especially our hips, especially our shins that we work on. Like I said, team bonding, these are the days that they get to just be flexible, check in on each other. It's not the 100% workout effort that you expect Monday, Wednesday. This is the 100% recovery aspect that they are feeling. I don't know who told me this quote, but it's always stuck with me. If today doesn't suck, you did yesterday's workout wrong. And that is basically how I run it. I want you to come into those workouts, push 100%, 110%, and then from there, your easy days are going to be easy. A lot of my guys specifically, oh, I crushed my 7-mile recovery run today at 6:50 pace, but I feel really tired. Okay, next time, we are going to slow it down to 8:30. Just let your body feel. I will hold your watch. I've done that for so many athletes, especially the guys. Go pick a route you know and just run it. Go based off feel, enjoy the day, talk with your friends, ask for help. Just enjoy music, do whatever you need. But these things, I'm not a babysitter. I don't like to sit there and count all their reps. They are going to get in what they put into it. So I sit there the whole practice. I watch them do hurdles. I watch them do all of their exercises. But from there, if I see athletes skip out and only do one or two exercises that they like and not the hard stuff, I let them go. I'm not gonna babysit them. The athletes that have dedicated and are there for the full 45 to an hour that it takes are the ones hitting those PRs. And they see that, and that jealousy comes. And this is the first thing I point back to, as well as the lifting. What are you doing that they aren't, right? Everybody's lives are different. You have other outlying factors with work and life and different experiences. But when it comes to running, you're having the same training, you're having the same mileage, you are having the same lifting and the same exercises. Where do we need to make that switch, okay? To reduce that jealousy, but also increase your own self-confidence. Building back, I think a lot of you all might experience shin splints, but I will say with that, or any injury, is you don't know how they're feeling. So trust them when they say something is hurting. It's really easy, even at my level, to just say, oh, they're faking it, they want to get out of the hard workout today. And you're gonna have those athletes, okay? That's another whole other attitude problem you might have to work through. But the shin thing or an injury thing, trust them when they say something's hurting and go to your trainer, go to a PT, refer out. Your job as a coach, and that is what you can do. You can't solve all their different issues, but invite people in. So when you have those kids that are returning back from injury, this is a set example. I have of one athlete right now who the night before a conference meet was previewing the course. She slipped and fell, and at the time it did not show a fracture. 2 weeks later she went back, she had fractured her shin, she had raced her conference meet on it. So she is now coming back, but we are starting with walk-run variations. I like to do two successful before we change a factor. So if you can do 4-minute walk, 1-minute run for 30 minutes total, no pain, cross-training day, 4-minute walk, 1-minute run, 30 minutes total, good, no pain. Thursday, you're still in your cross-train. Friday, we're going to try something different and see how it feels. I have had success with this for 3 different athletes who are now, Kaylin, Peyton, and Bella is doing just fine with this. They are coming back even stronger than they were before. Involve the athlete. Involve your trainer. Have multiple people on the same page with these return to run plans, because it's not going to hold you accountable, it's going to hold your athlete accountable. If everybody's on the same page where, oh, they told me to do one thing, so I'm going to do this. No, I know that she didn't say that. She told you to do this, and this is what you're going to do. Okay, so make sure they know. Keep them invested as much as you can in practice. I think mentally, especially when they're not able to run, they're not able to do the thing they love, it takes a toll on them. So make sure that you can connect with them and say, how is it going? Do we want to change anything else? Invite in a bike, a rower, an elliptical if necessary, but making sure that you have those ways to keep it interesting, keep it fun. With the lifting, make sure they advocate for what they need. If it's in pain, let's switch it up. Make sure you have those adaptations ready. The one complaint I could probably make about River Falls is that we do not have a pool. So if you have a pool and you have injured athletes, get them in there as much as possible. And if you think twice about it, think about me, wishing that I had your pool, and just come up with a couple different variations for them to get in there and get off their feet. My non-negotiables in between seasons are 2 weeks completely off. I just, not only physical, they're not going to lose that much fitness, if any at all. Mentally, they need to step back. They need to be away from this routine that drains them a lot. So with each athlete, especially maybe your top athletes or especially your slower athletes that you want to see improve or you feel like they have potential, meet with them and say, how much time do you need off? I need 10 days. Okay, 10 days, we're going to check in and we're going to see if you're ready to go or if we need 11 or 12. Okay, or 14, that's fine too. Some athletes, I know some of my top athletes say after about 3 days, I'm itching to get running again. And I'm like, I feel you, but you're going to make at least 7. So we take at least 7, part of that 2 weeks, the next week is going to be active recovery. Just move your body in ways that isn't running. You can bike, elliptical, do yoga, you can dance, do whatever makes you happy, but we're not going to start your training yet, at least until these 2 weeks are done. Continue to lift. Make sure, just especially with females, we want to continue to keep that lifting up and make sure that we build those muscles. In between each season, as well as about 3 to 4 times throughout the semester, I have one-on-ones with my student athletes. So I come in, they talk to me for 30 minutes. We talk about freshmen especially, how are you doing translating into college? Are you feeling good? Feeling bad? How's it all going? Then we talk about mental health, stress factors, as well as anything else that you feel I'm lacking for you. College and high school, it's really hard to be in a situation where you're like, my PR was this, and they're like, that was 45 years ago, that wouldn't even be in our top 10 now. And you're like, okay, thanks. So really making sure the biggest and best thing you can do for your student athletes is hear them. What else can I do to support you? Do you feel like you're lacking on tempo runs? Do you need more speed? What do you feel you need? Listen to them and understand that, and especially during those season breaks, you can make those adjustments, okay? Divide into groups, like I said, being able to switch them around. If they're a freshman, have them try everything. Whether that be a 200, whether that be a 400, just to get out of their system. Try them at the 2 mile, make them do the mile, get the 800. They're gonna learn and grow what they like and don't like, and they're also gonna find what they're strong at. Maybe they never even thought they'd be good at the 2 mile, and they hop into it and they run a really, really strong time. Suddenly that confidence builds and it's exciting. All my freshmen that are distance kids will run an 800, will run a 1K, a mile, a 3K, and a 5K their freshman year. I don't want to limit them, and I don't want to say or pigeonhole them. Oh, you did the 800 in high school, you're now an 800 runner in college. We're going to try everything, okay? I was an 800 runner in high school, and I can't even imagine doing an 800 now. I was 3K, 5K in college, and I am happy about it. So making sure you just find those groups. Push them out of their comfort zone. One other thing Dilley Taylor said, have high expectations met with high love. You set low expectations for your student athletes, it's just disrespectful to them. You want them to succeed. Be realistic with them. Let them know you believe in them to hit a certain time or hit a certain place or do a certain job. Do not lowball them. That is just gonna set them up to spiral. Continue to feel as though you're training throughout those different seasons. Even on your 2 week break, you still eat as though you are training at 100%. That is a big thing I tell my athletes. Examples of summer and winter break training, and I heard them clapping, so I'll continue to wrap it up here. Be flexible in your summer and winter break, making sure that you know they have family time, they're gonna travel, they're gonna work. How are you gonna work with them to build in just different mileage days or days off? Be flexible with them when they say they have other things happening. After either your track season or after your cross-country season, work with them, your whole team, to set goals. Next year, I want to hit this. Next year, I want to go to state. Next year, we're going to do this. Keep them invested. Keep them motivated throughout the summer and the winter to hit those goals. Build slowly, especially in the summer. You don't need to be in your peak fitness until November. So really take that into account, build slowly in your different cycles. Have check-ins. I don't know your guys' rules of how much you can interact with them, but really make sure that you have check-ins just mentally. How are you doing? You've been away from me for a while. I haven't seen you. How's home life? How are we liking running? Do we need a break? How are you going to do? throw in some 5Ks, fun runs that they can do with their friends that aren't runners or their family. Just go back to the basics. Build mileage slowly, long runs, hills, create variety. If you want to just play around with different workouts during those times, do it and invest in those. Nutrition, one of my favorite things is this cravings table. If an athlete is craving something, they're probably missing something. So pay attention to all of these different symptoms and signs. One of the best things my high school coach did for me was interject when she noticed that I was struggling with eating and was going to hold competition away from me because it was not worth me putting myself in a bad place to be able to compete for her. Okay, this is more of what you as a coach can do for those student athletes, and they might be mad at you for a while for holding them out of competitions, but it's the whole life you're thinking of. I have helped multiple athletes out of competition for mental health as well as eating disorders. They're mad for about a day, and then after that, they're like, yeah, I should probably go get help. So take that what you will. Repetitive injuries, any comments that they're making about their body language, shut them down. Any of my athletes say fat, they're kicked out of practice because I don't have that tolerance, I don't have that patience. Significant weight loss, any safe foods or routine, only keeping those foods, pay attention to those, as well as if women lose their period. During my one-on-one check-ins with my women, I ask them, do you have your period? And they say yes or no, and we go from there. And I say, I'm not trying to be creepy, I'm not trying to be over-involved in your life. For me as your training, I know that we are in a good spot, you're still getting that record. So, have those conversations, they may be uncomfortable, have somebody else in the room, but make it known that you have their best interest in her. Iron, we talked about that. My ferritin was 5, my hemoglobin was 9. I don't know how my doctor just didn't say stay in this hospital bed and don't move.
Yeah.
So make sure that you pay attention to pale skin, abnormal fatigue, anything that just seems like they can't do what they usually do. Maybe it's depression, maybe it's anxiety, maybe it's mental health, maybe it's iron. My life changed drastically after I had all that iron in me. So, again, with the weight, my version of that is that your weight is just a number that shows your impact on that earth, on this earth, and that's pretty powerful. Do something with it. Take up space, own your space, and be proud of where you are. Invest in the sport for you, high school coaches. If you see athletes that want to compete collegiately, bring in alumni who have competed collegiately. Bring in professional running groups if you can. Bring in athletes who at the collegiate level have been through it so that they can have a firsthand experience of this is what it was like. I'm at this place. I love it. I connect to my coach because I value that when I was going through the recruit process, right? What is it really like after that visit is done? What is it like that first week of training when everything's different? How did you get through that? Have them come back, especially with athletes that want to run, so that they know, okay, that is truly what I want to do, or that sounds really scary, I think I'm good. That's fine. Just let them know. Take accountability for their training, track mileage so that they do that. I'll show you my training log that I have. Shoes. I have some high school athletes that come to our camp at River Falls. They are pronating the heck out of their shoes, and they're like, my shins just constantly hurt. I'm like, okay, let's get you in some stability shoes and like watch your life change. So pay attention to any shin issues or any pronation or overpronation, supination, sorry. Pay attention to that and get them in the direction of what they need for shoe wear. Nutrition, hydration, visualization, confidence, positive self-talk. That is the big abilities to be able to invest in it to get to that next level. Watches, make sure they have a watch. You don't need to sit there with 18 stopwatches hoping for the best. And teach what it takes for college running. Be an advocate for them, talk, respond to college coaches. We love it when you do. Be honest about ability. Find a different way that they can advocate or at least work with them to say, you want to run at Madison? Okay, you're going to need to run this time. Are you willing to commit to that or not? Okay, yes, let's do it. If not, here are your other options. All divisions at the collegiate level are impressive and they provide different experiences, so make sure you're open and honest about that as well. Training log, they track mileage. I also ask them to track sleep so we can make a change. I do this for all my athletes. It's just them, me and them, so that if they don't come up to me and talk to me at practice but I know something wrong, I check this first before I text them because half the time a paragraph is written in the comments section. So this is a way that we can build and just have that relationship, continue to trust, find different ways of communicating with athletes. But also if they had a great race, we're going to look back at 2 or 3 weeks like, I got nothing from it. Maybe I got one thing from it. But these are some of the numbers that I've had success with in the past 18 months I've been at River Falls. Majority of it was getting them into shape, teaching them, especially my girls, how to run farther than 4 miles. My first workout of practice last year, they came up to me and said, can we just go back to school now? Because 2 miles and 2 miles is 4 miles, and we've never run more than 4 miles in our life. Yep, go back. I don't know what I'm going to do. Like, go back. So just a little bit of that. Understand your role. Trust yourself. Set boundaries. You can't give everything to every single athlete, but take the time to do so. You're not a counselor, dietitian, babysitter. You can be a friend, but don't be too friendly. There's that line. Figure it out for yourself. And you're not a current student athlete. You don't know how things have changed since you've been in their positions. Advocate for them, understand, and try and empathize with what they're going through. But you are a human, you're a mentor, you're a coach, you can have your bad days too. Celebrate accordingly. When they win, it's for them. Let them have it. Trust the process. I told you a couple of the DLG Taylor quotes that stuck with me. Goal setting, what does every day look like? Find good training partners. These last two, be their biggest fan, no matter if it's your varsity athlete making to state, or if it's your slowest runner hitting that huge PR they've been working for, you celebrate all the same. All the same. Some of these athletes have maybe never believed in themselves, they've never known what that looks like. Teach that to them, but make sure that you're not their only self-belief, and you're not their only source of it. So, give them tools, be open and honest about your own experiences, be relatable, and love them in any way you can. I think I've gotten through this, I've hammered it home with you guys. Just remember that you're humans first, athletes second. Your training can do wonders, but I think just the way you connect with your athletes and your kids is going to make the biggest difference. Any questions on anything? I threw a lot at you. This is me, this is my energy pretty much all the time. But any questions on anything? I know you guys probably want to get to the next session. But... Well, thank you.
Thank you, Megan.